things that I really appreciate the most about Seller Central is that we can control our pricing. Really, no matter what, we may lose the buy box if Amazon's pricing is too high, but we can control our pricing. The analytics on Seller Central are light years better than what was available on Vendor Central.
This is the E-Commerce Brain Trust, a podcast about building momentum online for established consumer brands. Join our hosts and their expert guests for high-level conversations about e-commerce strategies, trends, and innovations. Access our brain trust and boost your brand's e-commerce potential.
Hello and welcome back to the E-Commerce Brain Trust podcast. I'm your host, Kiri Masters, and today I've got two guests on the show. One, a returning guest, Jordan Ripley from Bobsled Marketing. Welcome back, Jordan.
Thanks, Kiri. Thank you for having me.
And we also have a client of Jordan's, James Ray from Little Seed Farm. Welcome to the show, James.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
So Little Seed Farm crafts organic, nourishing skincare using eco-friendly and recyclable packaging, 100% solar-powered, good for your body and good for the earth, and very well known for their natural deodorants or healthy deodorants. And Jordan was also mentioning, as a new dad, excellent baby products as well.
That's right. I recommend the Booty Bomb.
Good stuff. And the reason why I was really eager to get James on the show today is Little Seed Farm, with regards to their Amazon status, fairly recently made the switch from being a vendor on Amazon and moving over to Seller Central, where they now sell directly to customers on Amazon. And I know that this is a topic that we've covered in the podcast in the past, and it's something that a lot of brands who are currently vendors feel concerned about making the switch for various reasons. And so it's always good to share a success story to show how it's done. So James, if you could kick us off and tell us a little bit about Little Seed Farm's history with Amazon up until you decided to make the switch to Seller Central.
Yeah, absolutely. So we started out with Amazon as a Vendor Central account. Their buyer had contacted us at some point about a year and a half ago. And up until that point, we hadn't really focused on Amazon at all. So her offer to create all of our listings and to get us on Prime and to get, you know, everything set up kind of on our behalf with minimal kind of back end work for our team really is what sold me, because I just didn't want to jump into all the legwork that it took to get everything going on our own. So we took them up on that offer and started negotiations for a Vendor Central, you know, relationship. And within a few months, had everything up and running, and it was going pretty well. And so we just proceeded with that. We didn't really do a whole lot on the Seller Central side. Our profit margins were actually really nice on the Vendor Central side of things, so we didn't have much of a reason to consider Seller Central. So we just kind of kept the ball rolling that way. And we did enjoy our time with Vendor Central for sure.
It was appealing to you, that model, because it was pretty hands-off and you didn't really have to be as proactive as you would have needed to be on Seller Central.
Yeah, I think having the POs come in every week was nice. We didn't really have to do any forecasting or planning. You know, Vendor Central did kind of all of that for us, and we got accustomed to the steady stream of things. We could, of course, monitor the sales and do our own kind of internal production estimates and things, but we didn't have a whole lot of a need to, you know, work through. A lot of what we do now with Seller Central was pretty much automated by Vendor Central. So you get in that routine, and that was, like any routine, is just a nice, easy thing to do every week. And, you know, they paid when they said they would pay and charge the fees that they said they would charge and all of that stuff. So we couldn't complain. You know, ultimately, what ended up happening was about 8 months into the launch off with Vendor Central, the purchase orders literally just stopped coming, and there was no communication from anyone at Amazon. So we didn't really know what was going on.
This was back in February.
Yeah, this is in February. And it was kind of a weird situation. You know, they had a whole bunch of inventory in their warehouses. So they continued to sell that down. And what we did was basically, you know, start. We had a Seller Central account. So we effectively migrated a lot of that information over there with the help of Bobsled, of course, basically made that transition as smooth as possible. We had a gap of a month or two. Vendor Central like to keep 6 to 8 weeks of inventory on hand. So we had a couple of months gap where, you know, we weren't shipping as much inventory. We were basically trying to manage the inventory at Vendor Central without really knowing what they had on hand and not getting Seller Central overstock. So that gap was a little bit of kind of a strain on cash flow, you know, with regard to that specific account. But overall, it went real smooth and the listings, you know, stayed the same. The inventory started shipping FBA instead of, you know, by Amazon directly. And really, I think from a customer perspective, very little changed. So that was perfect. All of our reviews and, you know, everything associated with the product listings remained the same. So it was pretty seamless transition. And overall, you know, we're much happier with Seller Central, I think.
Yeah, I think that your story is often the exception, at least from our perspective, that there's usually some more painful things going on with Vendor Central. Like you mentioned, profitability was pretty good, so you didn't have a problem with that. Something that a lot of other brands face on Vendor Central is pricing control. So because Amazon is selling the items, they can price them however they want. And sometimes that leads to channel conflict for brands that ends up being quite painful. Was that ever an issue for you on Vendor Central?
Yes. And it's still kind of an issue on Seller Central, but you do have, yeah, Jordan knows all about that. It's actually happening right now with our second bestseller.
Spoke too soon.
Yeah, I think that's the broader issue with Amazon, but with Vendor Central, you're right. They own the inventory, they do what they want with it, and you're not telling how to manage it. So when the product would go on sale at competing websites, Amazon would lower their price. The nice thing about that with Vendor Central was that it didn't impact our margin because they had already purchased the product. So at least in our relation, if they had bought the product for $10 and then all of a sudden wanted it on sale for 50% off, they were losing, you know, a few bucks for every product of ours that they sold. Whereas now with Seller Central, if our product goes on sale on a competitive mass website, it's our duty from Amazon's perspective, if we want to keep the buy box, to cut our price in half on Amazon also, even if it's not our choice on the competitive website to drop that price. So it's the price matching requirement from Amazon can be pretty frustrating sometimes.
Good. Well, I want to turn over to Jordan now and put him on the spot a little bit. But this was, I think, everyone's assessment, really a pretty smooth transition. Sometimes we see a lot more go wrong with a vendor to seller transition, things like buy box eligibility issues. James mentioned there was that inventory availability gap, and sometimes that can be exacerbated a little bit. And then, of course, there is, in some companies where there has never really been a direct consumer kind of fulfillment operation, it's a big change internally to go from sending off wholesale POs all the time to actually getting inventory ready for individual sale. So in your view, what were some of the things that helped Little Seed Farms transition go particularly well in your view?
Yeah, I think James, being the optimist that he is, maybe glossed over a few things. You know, there were a couple of road bumps. Like when Little Seed first started working with Bobsled, I want to say about a week or so prior to that, James got an email from the vendor team notifying that his account had been suspended with no reason as to why. And it was kind of a faux suspension. Like
the seller account or the vendor account?
Vendor account, eh? And this has happened twice now. where, and it hasn't really interrupted business or anything, but like if we've tried to create cases with the vendor support team, there'll be times that we're locked out because the vendor code has been suspended. And we reached out to that team and asked, what's the root cause of the suspension? And, you know, speculation on our side was back when Amazon was trying to avoid having the same ASINs listed in both seller and vendor in a hybrid model, that perhaps that had triggered the suspension. But I never really did get a complete answer on that. Reached out to the vendor team multiple times, and then they finally just told us to stop asking and they wouldn't provide an answer. So that was like a fun way to kick off the whole transition. Thankfully, no major disruptions since most of the sales and inventory had been transferred to seller at that point. So got a little lucky and maybe a little skillful at the same time there. But I think the challenges that we were able to overcome to make this fairly smooth, largely due to, you know, James being overly communicative and having a lot of good systems in place on his end. But the two things that were important from the start was, one, yes, monitoring buy box, because it started in March at around 18% on the seller side, and then, you know, steadily doubled. So April, we were at 45%, May, 89%. By the time we hit June, we were at 98% plus and have kept that to date. So it was kind of monitoring vendor inventory, making sure that we had the inventory in stock on seller side so that it would be a smooth transition, and then making sure that buy box followed accordingly. So that worked fairly smoothly. The other thing was there were just some programs that Little Seed was enrolled in on the vendor side, like Subscribe and Save, Small and Light, things that, you know, are tied to a specific SKU. So those all had to be migrated as well. There are some sort of intricacies there that we had to navigate, but I believe we're entirely in Subscribe and Save at this point, and Small and Light is back on the correct SKUs. So there are some of those kind of components that you have to manage the migration between the two accounts, but, you know, again, all stuff that we can handle fairly successfully.
Yeah. And I would say that you did really well. I appreciate that.
James, have you seen any, are there any particular programs or other things about Seller Central that you weren't aware of before the transition that you have been pleased with?
Jordan may remember and have some thoughts on that also. So feel free to chime in, Jordan. But for me, the things that I really appreciate the most about Seller Central is that we can control our pricing. Really, no matter what, we may lose the buy box if Amazon's pricing is too high, but we can control our pricing. The analytics on Seller Central are light years better than what was available on Vendor Central. And the support is as good, I would say, at least, if not better. And then your ability to control the inventory is really nice. Like, we can overstock some inventory when we're slow, knowing that it's going to pick up and we're going to have a hard time keeping up, or vice versa. You know, we can add inventory ahead of sales, just things that Vendor Central doesn't seem to think about or let you have any input or management capability on, that ultimately are really important, you know, for your sales volume.
Two other things that kind of are top of mind for me on this one: amount of direct interface that you have with the end consumer. James and his team do a really good job of, you know, fostering relationships with buyers that reach out via messaging system, you know, providing conscientious responses to any sort of negative reviews. So a lot of that branding control that I think is seeded to some extent on the vendor side of things, I think is been a benefit in on the seller side. The other thing is just how nimble we've been able to be around product launches. There have been a lot of like top sellers that James has been able to spin off sample varieties of. And that way, you know, we can have parent variations that are focused purely on customer acquisition on a trial perspective that then, you know, funnel up to larger pack sizes, which would be kind of harder if you're dependent on Amazon buyers to place those orders. And we can, you know, pretty quickly launch a parent ace and have inventory in stock, provided they actually check in and at the warehouse and you know, aren't dependent on Amazon for a lot of that.
Yeah, it's really an important component also, is because, you know, we're a pretty small business. We're a very small business, and managing our own website gives us so much flexibility and our communications with our customers that come direct to littleseedfarm.com. And what I love about Amazon and the Seller Central side of it is that it's so similar to running your own website. Yes, Amazon takes fees, but it provides a huge value as well. So I've never viewed Amazon's fees as excessive necessarily. You know, I'd love it if they were lower, of course, but at the same time, they're necessary for the value that Amazon provides to its customers. And having the listings under your control, being able to add new listings, the approval process is pretty simple. And, you know, when it comes down to things like sample packs, there's pretty much no way, I think, that the buyers on the end, on the Vendor Central side of things, would have approved something, you know, with a price point of like $3.99, which is what our sample packs are at. And there's just a lot of things that probably wouldn't jive well with Vendor Central that now with Seller Central, we can utilize in a way that we would on our own website that we've seen work over the past 2 years. And now that we're really excited to push on the platform.
Excellent. And in terms of it's been the entire process end to end was about how long? I know that the, you know, what do you consider the quote unquote end of the process to be, but all up, was it a 2 month process to more or less switch over?
Yeah, it was probably right around there, maybe three. I think the original anticipation was for it to be 2 to 3 months. And I think the vast majority of it was done within the first few weeks. And then there was just some little stuff kind of trickling out there that wasn't necessarily ours or Bobsled's fault. It's just kind of stuff hanging in Vendor Central world until it resolved itself.
Yeah, I have the numbers in front of me, and March was still heavily vendor, so it's only 18% buy box for the entirety of March. By the time May hit, it was close to 90% buy box seller. So really, yeah, the bulk of that work was end of March too.
Yeah, and that's just pretty much from an inventory perspective too, because Vendor Central is going to dominate the buy box 9 out of 10 times. So yeah, it took them 2 or 3 months to sell through what's in hand. But I think the preparation on our end for the transition was pretty much within like 4 to 6 weeks.
Okay. And has there been any appreciable difference in sales after switching, unit sales?
Yeah, I think, yeah, I mean, I know so for sure. It's hard to tell because our brand was so young to begin with on Amazon and we were learning how to go to market on that channel still. So the growth was still pretty high back in February and March and remains pretty high. But I would think just off the top of my head that we're at least doing double now on Amazon what we were back in February and March. And of course, with Vendor Central, the analytics would be poor. But yeah, deodorant cream in general has just kind of found its own niche and is just chugging right along. So that's been awesome.
That's really great.
Oh, I was just going to say another intricacy that kind of was a confounder during this time was, you know, as the real shift in sales was completing, you know, we were also entering Prime Day. So hit 90% buy box in May, and then we have about 6 weeks to figure out, you know, how much of this growth is purely from transition and then how much of this growth is seasonal lead up to Prime Day. So it was a little bit of sticking a finger into the wind and hoping we could just run heavy on inventory, but that helped things escalate pretty quickly too.
Yeah, I was just wondering, are your products generally seasonal? Because I can see them as being really giftable and having a good pickup over Q4, but people would use more deodorant over summer. So I was trying to figure out what would be your high season.
Yeah, it's nice because the products kind of offset each other a little bit. Our other categories, skincare lineup, hand balm, moisturizers, body oils, toners, things like that are all more heavily used in the drier winter months. And they're also really good gifting options. So are our bar soaps, which are not available on Amazon just because of their price point and their margins don't work with Amazon's fees. But on our website, obviously, that's a huge seller for us. So we really see the deodorant start picking up in the springtime. And you know, now is kind of like peak deodorant wearing season. And then as we hit back to school, kids and their families are not vacationing as much. They're not at the pool all day. And you see it start to trend down right when our fall holiday season is picking up. So it levels out the business really nice. And there's, you know, obviously the holidays are crazy, but our summer now with the deodorant is a lot busier than it used to be.
Gotcha. All right, great. Well, so just wrapping up here, and you mentioned to me that listening to this podcast was actually a helpful resource for you when you were trying to figure out whether to make the switch. So do you have any advice for the listeners today who might be current vendors about what they should be thinking about when they transition, if they transition?
Yeah, at least for us, we had a Vendor Central account and a Seller Central account open at the same time. I'm assuming that's okay.
Yeah. You're not alone in not knowing what the rules are. I think that there's a lot of different messaging out there from Amazon.
Right.
So some vendors got pretty specific messaging from Amazon to say that they could not sell on the marketplace. And I know that they were enforcing that. So our viewpoint has been, if Amazon's told you you can't sell on the marketplace, don't try and sell on the marketplace. But if you haven't heard anything, like in your case, and your buyer had left and you couldn't even contact anyone anyway, then there has been no situations I've heard of where people making that transition who haven't been told not to have gotten into trouble.
Gotcha. Okay. So what I would tell other brand managers is, if you have the opportunity to sell on Seller Central and it's not in direct conflict with what Amazon has told you you're allowed to do on their platform, then it doesn't hurt to create some listings for products that you may not have on Amazon already, or that at least don't conflict with your Vendor Central offerings, and get familiar with the platform, see the analytics improvement, see the listings control, the pricing control, inventory control that Seller Central provides. And, you know, if that's something that you find appealing and the extra access to knowledge and the little bit of extra work that it takes to manage as well isn't something that will hold you back, but in fact you enjoy, I would definitely consider it. For us personally, as long as we're allowed to sell on Seller Central, I think we will. And any invitation back to Vendor Central, I think we would be a little more scrutinizing of. And unless we were forced to only sell on Vendor Central, I think we would pretty much prefer to stick with Seller Central.
Good stuff. Anything from your perspective, Jordan? Any advice for others?
No, yeah, I think James hit the nail on the head. The best way to know is to just dip your feet in and see if Seller is the right platform for you. James, should we start plugging your product at Whole Foods yet, or is that still a question mark?
That is a question mark. Yeah, we'll be sharing some Amazon data with them. Hopefully that's something that they want to know about and hear about. So I don't know. It's new. It's new for us. We don't go pitching and selling buyers too much. We've been fortunate enough to have them kind of come to us over the years. So this will be me and Eileen, the other co-founder, and my lovely wife, kind of out of our element and comfort zone and talking to Whole Foods buyers. So by having the Amazon sales data and some statistics behind, along with a product that we really love and believe in, certainly can't hurt. So I think it's going to go pretty well.
Good stuff. And before we can buy Little Seed Farms products at Whole Foods, listeners want to check out your products. Where's the best place to do that?
Yeah, sure. Well, assuming everyone's Amazon customers, of course, you can find our most on Amazon. But if you do want to learn more about us, see some pictures of our farm, learn more about what we do from a sustainability standpoint, which is a huge focus of our business, you can go to littleseedfarm.com. And if you would like, you can use the code BOBSLED for 15% off your first order.
Awesome. Thank you for that. Much appreciated. Thanks for being a client of Bobsled Marketing. It's been great working with you, and just really great to see such a positive outcome of your transition here.
Yeah, well, thank you very much for making it so seamless, and we look forward to what the future holds. It's been a lot of fun.
All right. Thank you, Jordan. Thanks, James.